he doing?
On this episode of Bondi Vet.
Two little orphan babies. Splish, splash.
Audrey and Alison race to save young injured wildlife washed up by floods.
And it's really heartbreaking. You have to make a judgment call. How far do you go? Can you save them?
Hello, ladies.
How are you?
Scott helps the victim of a hoarding situation with a horrific leg injury.
Maybe she had the foot bitten and it's fallen off, or that she's got a leg caught. It's frightening to comprehend.
That's not what I expected.
And what could possibly be lurking inside this rare Fijian iguana?
This isn't a situation where I have to go searching for what I'm looking for. It's right there.
Wow.
You make my world a better place.
Come on, there's your girl.
South of Sydney, twin vets Audrey and Alison have just arrived at the Possumwood Wildlife Sanctuary.
I have missed this place.
Today the sun is shining, but recent floods across eastern Australia have left dozens of orphaned and injured animals needing veterinary care.
So Possumwood, as well as being a sanctuary and home to hundreds of kangaroos, it's also a very busy wildlife hospital. We really have our work cut out for us when we arrive. There's kangaroos, wombats, possums, turtles. It's just non-stop.
Hi, sweetie.
How are you?
Good.
Been busy here?
Yeah, so we've had a lot of animals come in over the last few days, and one in particular, you'll need your attention straight away, is a little boy called Joe. He's got this big swelling in his face. He must be in a lot of pain and, you know, it's very badly infected.
Whoa, that's bad.
So I'm not quite sure what you're going to find underneath that, but it's not going to be nice.
The eye is actually quite shocking, or the area underneath the eye. There's quite a lot of swelling. We know there's quite a lot of pus as well. And at this point, we just don't know where it's coming from.
So this lump is actually under the eye. Oh, that third eyelid is so inflamed from this abscess. So looking at how bad that infection is and the extent of it, if we left that infection any longer, that could seed into his blood. And once that happens, he's in really, really bad trouble. He could potentially die from that.
Oh, there's a cavity that goes all the way up in there. I can actually stick my finger in it. And there's so much food in it.
Oh, hang on.
I open that mouth and I have a good look, and I can actually see there's this huge cavity going up into that area where the pus is, and my finger can actually go all the way up. So we definitely know it's coming from the mouth.
It's got a loose tooth.
Yeah,
it's a tooth root abscess. So we're looking at two really wobbly infected premolars, and because they're so wobbly and infected, that pus is accumulated around the roots and into that area under his eye. So I think what's gonna happen when I pull this tooth out is all this pus is gonna run out. So we're just packing out the back of his throat so it doesn't go down his lungs. Whoa, man. That looks like part of his jaw bones just kind of
fractured away
with that tooth. Oh, the infection must be in the jawbone. So it's pretty smelly and nasty in there. Just in that cavity behind the infected teeth, we can see grass, oats, decaying food there.
Oh, it comes in waves. And what we think may have happened is that the infection is also eating away at that jaw.
Okay, there's still a bit of jawbone up here, but I might have to get it out from here.
Oh God, he's going blue.
Is he not taking breaths?
Suddenly, little Joe is struggling to breathe.
Can you just give him some pure oxygen, please? All right, let's do 10 breaths. Close, one, two, and then open, three. Open all the way, three. Oh yeah, he's going pink now. Did you just stop breathing, maybe? His tongue is completely blue.
Yeah. Oh, the pus is coming out the eye now.
With Joe stable once more, the twins can now tackle his infected jawbone.
We're gonna just try and nurse the abscess from the outside.
I'm just putting my finger through the root area where we removed that tooth, and I can feel a piece of bone that we need to get out there. So if I sort of hold the eyeball away and then you cut in a ventral motion downwards, mm-hmm. so that way, mm-hmm. I can feel the bone with my finger right here. Okay, ready?
Yep. Just move your finger.
That's it. Get ready for the smell.
Oh, it's strong. Oh.
Oh. Oh,
there's so much pus coming out there.
Oh, that's a lot.
So I think possibly he fractured his upper jaw.
With the abscess now completely drained, Audrey and Alison x-ray Joe's jawbone to see exactly how much damage has been done.
It'd be interesting to see exactly what part and how much he's lost.
So that's the top jaw here, that's the soft tissue swelling where the abscess was. That's where we removed the two teeth. And you can see there's some bone loss here, so that's where it's all started.
So just having a look at that x-ray, we can see the area of the jaw that's actually come away with the tooth. And I think there's probably some sort of traumatic injury, hit by a car, where that's really fractured that bone and then caused all this secondary infection. So lucky little man to make it today, and I'm sure he's feeling a lot better with all that pus and discharge out of his face.
Nice and warm.
While Joe recovers from his gruelling surgery, it's time for Alison and Audrey's next patients, baby wombat Splish, and a tiny Joey named Splash.
You want to come out of the pouch?
Splish, Splash.
Splish and Splash, are you going to be besties?
This pretty much sums up the work here. Two little orphan babies.
Found in the horrible, horrible torrential rains.
Yep. And they've come to the right place to get you all better.
Best place in the world.
So this is the most favourite part of our job, those sneaky little moments where we can actually have a cuddle, and it's just the most gorgeous thing.
Okay, let's have a look at these wounds, Splish.
Today, Splish is getting a checkup.
So we're checking out Splish. He's had some wounds on his back because he was actually attacked and bullied by other wombats when he was flushed out of his burrows. And he's also got a skin condition that we've been asked to look at.
So I think all those wounds are actually granulating and healing. Definitely no more maggots, no more pus. But the rest of his skin is looking a bit mangy.
Mange is caused by a parasitic mite that burrows into the skin of its host. Without treatment, wombats can become emaciated and even die from infections caused by scratching.
Hey, Mr. Man, can we have a listen to your heart?
Your little wiggle bum. Can we have a look at your teeth?
Yeah.
You don't like it.
So I'm pretty happy with how he's going. He's, gaining weight. Apart from the mange, which I think we can get on top of,
and that's quite easily treatable.
Yeah.
Luckily, little Splish is already showing signs of recovery, but not every case has a happy ending.
So one of the hardest things about wildlife work is deciding, when an animal comes in, how far do you go? Can you save them?
There's a head tremor.
And it's really heartbreaking because you have to make a judgment call. You have to analyse that animal, see the amount of pain, see whether it's treatable or not, and that's really the hardest part of our job.
But we always say every life is a life worth saving.
Yeah.
And if they can be saved and we can release them and they'll do well, we're going to do that.
Yeah, that's what we're here for.
Hi, Audrey, Alison. Here we go, Miss Joe.
Joe, how did he go last night?
24 hours later, the twins are anxious to discover whether Joe the Joey will be one of Possumwood's survivors.
Oh, look at that.
That third eyelid has retracted all the way back and it's no longer red and angry, so that's a huge improvement.
You can see that pressure's really off the eyeball now that he can close that eye.
There's no damage there, which is great.
Maybe we're just going to have a look in your mouth, babe. Yeah, definitely smells a lot better.
Yeah.
So we're really happy with Joe's recovery. He's done really well overnight.
Oh, can you see us a bit better now?
Still a little bit groggy from the sedation, so we'll bring him to bed, and once he's recovered, I'm pretty sure he's going to be bouncing around in no time.
Doing very well.
Scott's heading off to Berkshire to visit another one of his favourite women at her rescue sanctuary.
Dinner time.
Jill's incredible. I mean, she dedicates her entire life to looking after border collies, animals that have come from desperate situations, and they come to her house and the heaven that she offers. She fixes them up, she feeds them, she loves them, and then she sends them on to new homes. She's an absolute saint as far as border collies are concerned.
Hey, Jill, how are you?
Oh, hello, Scott.
Today, Jill's asking Scott for help with a new patient.
So, I was coming to see Kizzy, your 3.5-legged dog.
Yes.
And cute little Snowy. So, should we have a look at her?
Yes.
Kizzy's story is quite a sad one. She was rescued from a lady who was hoarding dogs, and then when she went into hospital, the dogs were then left to starve.
There were probably about 30 dogs. They were all in filthy, appalling conditions. Kizzy was found cowering in the corner. She had 3.5 legs, and she was absolutely petrified of everybody. And at that point, we didn't know that Kizzy was actually having a baby as well.
Little Snowy would be Kizzy's only puppy.
Hello, ladies. Hello. How are you? Hello, you. Hello, you. Hello, you. Come in here. Oh, look how cute you are. Hello.
Hi, Kizzy. Hi, sweetheart. Okay. Kizzy's situation is impossible to comprehend, frightening to do so, in fact. It's a bit of a mystery as to how Kizzy has lost this leg. There's really only two options. One of them is that maybe she had the foot bitten and it's fallen off, or that she's got a leg caught and then it's actually been broken and then snapped off.
So the mind absolutely boggles to think what she's been through.
While 12-week-old Snowy hasn't a care in the world, Jill is worried that Kizzy is still feeling pain in her mutilated leg.
Not used to a lead in her former life, eh?
No, no.
Come on, sweetheart, you're gonna walk on this?
Come on, you're gonna follow
do you know
your
what
puppy.
A lead does?
Oh, good,
good girl.
She's a dog that's been physically damaged, is emotionally hammered, and she just seems like a lost soul.
Hello, beautiful. So let's have a little look, shall we?
I'm gonna do my absolute best to do anything I can to get her back on track.
One of the things is I don't think that she's quite balanced with it. And the other is it appears to throb a lot.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, well, I can see that the loss of the foot is actually just above the ankle, fractured straight through there and left her with a very strange amputation.
I had a good feel of the leg and the knee, but what was most telling was how she was throwing her leg forward. She was doing that because she still had a knee, but the knee joint is only of use if you've got a foot to place on the ground. She doesn't.
The knee is actually throwing her off balance, and it's a pointless joint.
Yeah.
And if you have any concern that there's any discomfort from the end here, I do think that amputation is the way to go. And that would just mean that she's a bit more comfortable, and also that we're getting rid of some of the weight in that leg, and hopefully the throbbing as well.
Yeah.
Scott will now take Kizzy back to his Richmond practice for surgery. But there's another passenger coming along for the ride.
Kizzy had never been allowed to keep a puppy. The local farmer used to just come in and drown them.
Good girl. That's one.
So this little puppy is very special to her.
Stay in there, good girls. Hey, not so keen on the practice, are you, hey? Good girls, whoa. Oh, goodness me. Snowy doesn't know of all the traumas that Kizzy's been through, and he's a happy, healthy, boisterous pup.
Oh, dear.
Kizzy, on the other hand, is quite nervous and quite shy, and I think, actually, the daughter is bringing the mother out, and I think that's a beautiful thing to see. You get in the warm, I will look after your babies and I'll give you a call as soon as they're done.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
See ya.
Yeah. Snowy will have to go with Kizzy.
Lovely.
They've never been parted. Hopefully Scott will be able to cope with both of them.
Hey, Nate. Scott, double trouble today. And this is Mum Kizzy.
I'll try and see if she'll walk for me. She's pretty nervous. She's very shy, and understandably so, considering everything she's been through.
Come on, sweetheart. Good girl.
Wow, that must be so much more extra effort on that. Yeah, and it's basically just throwing her completely off balance. She's throwing that knee forward, but she hasn't got a foot to place on the ground.
What her treatment needs to rely on, of course, is fixing what we can physically, and then hoping that with time and the right new owner, that she will
emotionally and mentally come good.
Syringe. Come on. Good girl.
Kizzy is booked in for surgery tomorrow, so Scott has relaxed the rules to allow Snowy to stay overnight as well. The 12-week-old puppy has never been separated from her mum.
There's a puppy. It's all right. Yeah.
Snowy being around reduces Kizzy's stress levels, and of course, going into a clinical environment, that's all important.
Good girls. Good girls. Well done.
One of the reasons why I love doing work with rescue animals is just to remind yourself that there are animals out there that desperately need your help and attention. I think it reignites your passion and why you'll continue to do the best job that you can to protect animals.
Student vet nurse Jess is keeping 12-week-old Snowy occupied while mum Kizzy is prepped for her big operation.
Thank you very much. Oh, good girl. Yes, you're a good girl.
Whoa, what do you think, Jem? She's gorgeous, isn't she?
She's so gorgeous. And our puppy. Oh, those eyes.
I know. And how much they love each other, I think, is just so sweet.
I know, yeah. I know. Puppy's being babysat upstairs.
Hey, Kizzy.
Kizzy is having an amputation today. At the moment, she's got a leg which is about sort of three quarters. She has a knee joint which is completely non-usable and it's throwing her off balance. And also there's the possibility of some throbbing pain at the end. So what we're gonna be doing is just shorting it up, making it a lot neater and hopefully giving her a good future.
Avneen, do you wanna just hold up the vein for me, please?
Today, Scott will be assisted by vet nurse Gemma and third year vet student Avneen.
So we're gonna do an amputation today.
Okay.
Have you ever seen one of them?
No, I haven't, so it'll be good for me to see.
There we go. Good girl, Kizzy. Brave girl.
Avneen's studying at Liverpool University and is doing a work experience placement with Scott.
It's a good girl. So brave. So brave.
It can be really heartbreaking treating a dog like Kizzy, who's had such a traumatic background. She's just so terrified, and knowing what she's been through, we don't want to hurt her or scare her anymore, but we do have to do it, and it's going to be better in the long run for her.
Can't imagine the life she must have had.
I know.
Pretty horrific.
Yeah, I think it's probably worse than you could even imagine. Time to sleep, honey.
Go to sleep for a little bit.
But as soon as Kizzy is put under anaesthetic, there are immediate problems.
Hey, Jeremy, if you can just hold the dog for a second. She's just a little white. Breathe. Basically, Kizzy is having a few problems breathing. So, it's a little worrying. I'm pulling the legs out and in to try and encourage Kizzy to breathe. I'm also giving her a bit of a rub and pressing on her chest, just trying to stimulate that breathing reflex.
Better.
Thankfully, she's starting to breathe.
A little bit of a scare there for Kizzy. Okay, not a good start.
Now that Kizzy's breathing is stable, the amputation can begin.
It's a big operation for Kizzy, and it comes with its own set of risks. Of course, she could have major bleeding, and she might even have sort of phantom pain as a result of losing the leg, but fingers crossed it should go very well.
Certainly not the most elegant of procedures. It's not something that you want to do as a vet, but in this case, it's absolutely going to make her life better.
For third-year vet student Avneen, this will be some initiation.
Expect to see a lot of blood, quite a bit, and hopefully just a smooth operation. Hopefully things go well.
How's everyone feeling? Everyone okay? All good?
Yeah.
All good? I've had vet students faint in surgeries before.
Okay.
So if you're feeling at all nauseated, then do tell me and just sit down. Don't try and run away, just sit down.
Okay.
You're gonna find all the large vessels are just basically running along the inside of the femur there.
Okay.
As Scott continues to carefully navigate around Kizzy's blood vessels, upstairs her 12-week-old puppy Snowy is being babysat by Jess.
She's quite attached to her mum, which is really sweet. Yeah. Mummy's gonna be here soon. She's gonna come round. Yeah?
We're actually quite close now to the point where we're exposing the bone, which means that we have to get out some fairly
heavy-duty equipment. So if you are delicate of stomach, look away now. So now the leg's off, it's all about closing the wound. So we're bringing back together all the muscles that we've cut through and try and get a result which means that it's nice and neat. Let's get this little lady working up next, shall we? So, Avanine, you're welcome to deglove and degown. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Kizzy's operation has gone really well. The vet student didn't fall over and faint, and all the nurses did a great job. So, yeah, really, really happy. Kizzy's woken up beautifully and she seems comfortable. So, yeah, it's great. It's time to see Mummy again and be nice and gentle. Okay, she's had a big operation today, hasn't she? Whenever I see cases of animal cruelty, obviously you feel a bit sad, but more than anything, I feel overwhelming anger. These are defenseless, innocent animals that just don't deserve the fate that they are suffering. And so when I see cruelty like that, it just plain angers me.
Oh, no way. That's all a bit much, eh?
Hi, Jill.
Hi, Scott.
Look who I've got. Let me give you Snowy.
Oh, Snowy.
Oh, did you miss her? Hey, did you miss Mummy?
Next day, Kizzy's recovered well enough for Scott to take her and Snowy home to Jill's rescue sanctuary.
Kizzy, Kizzy. Oh, sweetie. Hello. You okay?
When Scott came through, I felt very relieved to see Kizzy looking really quite bright after such a massive operation.
All right, Jill, well, I'll let you see it in all its glory, and you better see just how well she's managing
on those
three legs.
Yeah.
It's not like she's not used to walking on three legs.
No.
It's just a little bit neater now.
Yeah, yeah.
She's off. That's
it. Yeah, she's off.
I think having that flapping leg removed is going to be so much easier for Kizzy. I think she's going to be a lot more comfortable. It's amazing that she behaves as she does, considering where she's come from, because all this must be quite traumatic for her because she's never been out of that awful home. Terrible.
Kizzy has amazed me the way that she's dealt with the procedure. She is such a brave dog, but it's because of her history. She's had such a dreadful past that what we've done is just a drop in the ocean.
Is that your mummy? There.
Hopefully now it's a case of she's perfect.
Yeah.
She's just got a little bit of healing to do and then it's off to find a new home.
Yeah, it's wonderful. Thank you so much.
Oh, you know what? It's just such a small thing compared to what you do every day.
Well, no, it isn't. It's a big thing, a very big thing.
Well, I'm just happy to be a part of it.
It's been a wonderful result. And we're so grateful to Scott for what he's done. Very grateful.
Good luck, girls, in finding a new home.
How you doing?
Hey, good. How
Alex,
are you?
Isn't it?
Yeah, Alex.
Chris, how are you?
Nice to meet you.
Coming through, mate.
Chris is in Cairns helping out at the Marlin Coast Veterinary Hospital. And today, his first patient is an unusual one.
What is in the bag?
It's a bit of a special lizard, a bit of a surprise for you. They're quite an endangered species and we're part of a breeding program for them here at Cairns Tropical Zoo.
Okay.
Well, I heard that Chris was in town, so I brought in something a little bit different, a little bit rare, so I think Chris will be quite excited to see it.
Wow.
So this little guy here is a Fijian crested iguana.
Yeah. I've been to Fiji a lot of times and these guys, I know they're in a lot of trouble, aren't they?
They are, yeah. Their population is quite low. They've only found on a couple of islands around the Fijian archipelago.
Yeah.
This little iguana has been named Aku after a Fijian sporting star.
So what's what you're worried about him?
Well, his appetite's gone down and he just hasn't been himself lately.
So just not as energetic?
Basically, yeah, not as energetic. Hasn't been eating as much as he normally would and nowhere near as active as normal.
It's a tricky one. Can I just get your hole in there? I'm just going to get my stethoscope. Fijian crested iguanas are one of the rarest creatures in the world, so you have to make sure that each and every one of them is healthy and hopefully able to breed. But right now, the thing that's caused this guy to be off colour is a complete mystery. That all sounds fine. Both heart and lungs, all normal. Look, the fact that he's not eating like he should, makes you think that it's got something to do with his digestive system. So, you know, if we can really focus our search around his abdomen here, I think he feels a bit tense. You know, if anything, when I do push in there, it takes a little gulp and then all of a sudden he isn't so active. So there's some discomfort coming in here. And certainly he's what we call guarding. He's really trying to protect that belly of his.
Yeah, yeah.
He hasn't changed his diet at all?
No.
I'm at a bit of a loss to explain why he's shown the signs he is.
Mm-hmm.
I think probably the best thing to do right now is take an x-ray.
Okay.
If we do that, we'll get a good look, I guess, you know, inside that abdomen of his and just see if anything's bubbling away there.
He's a cool iguana. I've been working with him for probably the last coming up to 8 years now. So I guess grown up with him a little bit and got a bit of an attachment to him. So it's concerning to hear there could be something wrong going on in his abdomen. So hopefully we can get to the bottom of it pretty quickly.
X-ray.
Wow, that's not what I expected. This isn't a digestive problem at all. This is something completely different.
I take one look at Aku's x-rays and straight away, the weight lifts off the shoulders. It's there in plain sight. Aku has a bladder stone and a large one. But now comes a bigger concern. How do we get it out?
That would hurt. There are a couple of ways that you can get a bladder stone. Certainly it can be a metabolic thing, where you actually produce too many minerals and it starts to form a crystal, and a really big one at that. Or it can be a dietary thing, or it can be the result of infection. But the reasons why don't really matter so much right now, do they? No. So that's got to go.
They are an endangered species. There's not too many of them left, so each one is very precious to us.
All right.
There we go.
I've got some news that you're probably not going to expect.
Mm-hmm. He's actually got a massive bladder stone.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
So, I mean, I've never seen one of these before in an iguana. I mean, it is, we're talking, you know, that large.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
So, that would be the reason why he's been a bit off.
Mm-hmm.
He's carrying around probably about 30 grams of stone in his belly.
Yeah, right.
When I tell Alex, his face is one of slight confusion because he's not really sure whether he should be relieved or concerned. It's good news that it's not cancer, but at the same time, it's a worry, the fact that now Aku is facing major surgery.
So what's the next step, I guess?
You can try and dissolve these stones, but it will take many months. I don't think that's really fair on him to put up with the stone for all that time.
Yep.
The best thing to do would be to operate. Actually go in there surgically and remove that stone.
Okay.
So that's all right with you. We can do that today for you.
That'd be great. Yeah. Yeah, I think the sooner it's done, the better, really.
Yeah.
But
when you have bladder stones this large, you're talking about quite significant pain and usually quite significant infections as well. So for those reasons, I don't really want to delay on this. It's important we get Aku into surgery straight away.
Cool, man. Come with me. Lights are on.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Come on, little one.
So we'll try for the tail vein here.
Yep. Are you really sleepy now?
I'm about to operate on one of the rarest animals in the world. An animal that is notoriously difficult under anaesthetic. An animal that is quite old and an animal that has quite a significant medical problem. Yeah. You can understand why, right now, I'm a bit concerned.
The plan really is to cut down through the skin, through the abdominal wall, and my thinking is, straight after that, I should find what I'm looking for. All right, I'm now pretty happy with this opening incision. This isn't a situation where I have to go searching for what I'm looking for, because it's right there. That bladder stone is just dominating Aku's abdomen there. If there's any doubt as to whether that's it or not, that settles it.
It's not called a bladder stone for nothing. It is rock hard, and it is made of one big lump of crystal. It's heavy, and you just know it'd hurt like hell. For all those reasons, this lump has to come out now.
So believe it or not, that is the bladder, but the bladder is totally full. Full to the brim with rock. It's just all bladder stone.
The challenge now is to get the stone out safely.
So my hope is I can actually pull this bladder out and get it on the outside of the body. Maybe a dream. It's not really playing ball. So with any luck, if I can get these in the right place, we might just have some action here. It is egg-shaped, so I'm just trying to roll it over so I get the narrowest part. Try to squeeze it out. There we go. There it is. One big stone. Massive. Extraordinary. Living with that just had to be a nightmare. It's essentially made of minerals like calcium and phosphorus and magnesium, and they all bond together and form this rock.
You can't imagine the pain and discomfort that Aku has been experiencing up until this point. If Alex hadn't picked up on those subtle signs that Aku was showing, then his life would have continued to be absolute torture.
Let's give this a big flush. The worry we have is that because that bladder has been opened, and we know that bladder is full of bacteria because it's had the big stone in it, the concern is we can now spread that bacteria into Aku's abdominal cavity.
Any more?
No, that's good to start with.
Now Chris can start stitching up Aku's bladder.
This is really, really finicky. Everything is now shrunk down, that stone's gone, so it's absolutely microsurgery. That's the bladder now. I'm happy with how that's looking.
Finally, Chris can close up the wound.
This is just some antibiotics. And just provide a bit of an extra barrier to any infection taking hold. Okay, my Fijian friend is done, so it's time to wake him up. Chris, Tom. He's the same iguana, isn't he?
Yes.
He looks very different. Changed colour, buddy. What was that all about? What he's done is, because he's been on his back and under anaesthetic and getting cold, he's decided that if he darkens himself up, makes himself black, then he absorbs more heat. It's just one of those incredible adaptations these guys have. Okay, buddy. You ready? Here we go. Oh, no, you can't leave yet. No. No, you really can't. I know you think you're ready, and I appreciate that, but you're not. So let's just take it slow.
You would never know that this little guy has just experienced major abdominal surgery. He's up, ready, and keen to get moving. It is unbelievable.
You are fiery, aren't you? Alex is going to be here soon. So if you put on this sort of display, we'll be very impressed. But for now, just rest, huh?
Hey mate, how are you?
Not too bad, how did you go?
Good, yeah, it's been quite a day
yep. For
everyone. But he, look, he's just taken the no frills approach to it. He's unmoved, but you can see that's where he went in.
Oh, yep.
Just in there.
3 hours later, it's time for Aku to go home.
He should recover pretty quickly. That area tends to heal up beautifully.
Okay, so awesome.
After a few days, you should start to see that appetite of his returning. He should be a lot brighter than he was before.
Yeah, great.
He doesn't have that big rock sitting.
Be a lot more comfortable for him.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. Okay, but look, he's bounced back incredibly well after the anaesthetic.
Awesome. Oh, couldn't have gone any better then.
Yeah.
It's great to hear that the surgery went well and the bladder stone was removed successfully, and who knows, maybe he might be interested in breeding now because he is an endangered species, so each and every one of them is very important.
Let us know how he goes, mate.
Yeah, will do.
If he starts fathering some, we should know about it.
Yeah, thanks so much.
Okay, no worries, buddy. I'll put him back in here. It's a special day when, as a vet, you get to treat an animal that hopefully is one of the cornerstones of preserving an entire species. But today has been that day. Aku had a unique problem, but thankfully a problem we're able to fix, and hopefully now the rest of his life involves producing many more Akus.